I sang that song for more than 60 years, a song of praise to Joseph Smith, the prophet of the Restoration and founder of the LDS Church, the church I served as a bishop for 5 years. I knew the church was true. I was a faithful Latter-day Saint.
My life has been built on certain truths, but wishing doesn't change the truth.
Jesus said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free." When I finally learned the truth about the real history and doctrines of Mormonism, I realized that I was following the gospel of Joseph Smith and not the gospel of Jesus Christ. I have come to learn that many others have made a similar journey out of the bondage of religion and into an authentic relationship with Jesus. And that's what this show is all about. Courageous people who want to share their story, hoping that you, the viewer, will discover the same new life in Jesus. So if you're a Latter-day Saint who is struggling with questions or seeking a genuine encounter with the Savior, we invite you to join us tonight. We have a joyful message that we want to share with you. Hi, and welcome to another episode of the Ex-Mormon Files. I'm happy that you were able to join us. I'm Bishop Earle, and I appreciate you again spending some time with us. Today we have a very unusual guest, and I'm really happy to introduce her, Dorothy Glade. She's married to a former Mormon. She was never Mormon herself, but she has an interesting story and interacts with Mormonism, and I think you'll be impressed. And the more important thing and the good news that we try to share every episode here in Ex-Mormon Files is coming to Jesus and understanding who He is, what He did for us. And of course, in that regard, Dorothy's story is fantastic. So, Dorothy, thanks for coming and sharing.
Thanks for allowing me to be here. This is a huge honor.
Well, you mentioned or admitted that you watched a lot of the Ex-Mormon File.
I watched almost all of them. The past couple months I need to catch up, but
so you know all of my little weaknesses and idiosyncrasies and all that stuff.
Oh yes, yep, for sure.
Well, we'll try to avoid a few of those, but you were born Christian. You were born into a Christian home, is that right?
Yes. So my parents were both, they were Christian when I was born.
And where was that?
This was in Fairfax, Virginia.
Oh, okay.
That's where I was born. Yeah. We moved to West Virginia when I was 6, and my parents attended a Bible church my whole life, and I didn't like it. I did not like to go to church, but I was raised...
That's a youthful thing, don't you think?
Yeah. I mean,
okay, we're going
just
to church.
Just one of those rebellious things.
Now, I don't know if you know this, but when I was growing up as a young person and was facing that same thing, we used to go at like 7:30 in the morning for priesthood, about 11 o'clock for Sunday school, and about 4 or 5 o'clock for sacrament meeting. I mean, the whole day was...
I couldn't imagine. I could barely sit through an hour, like barely.
Yeah.
I was like, let's go, let's go.
And your mom and your folks were active though. And,
yeah. Well, my father, he worked 2 jobs and we didn't see him very often, but my mom took us to church every Sunday when she could make it.
Yeah. So you go to high school, and was there education there? Was it a regular public high school?
Yeah, or? Normal high school. I ended up transferring to a larger high school halfway through my freshman year. That was a huge culture shock, because if I would have stayed in the high school that I started in, my graduating class would have been 10 people.
Oh boy.
Yep, whole class. So, and culture shock.
Had you ever heard of Mormons? Had you ever run into a Mormon back there?
I had heard the term Mormon, but at the time, I didn't see a difference between Mormonism and Jehovah's Witnesses. I actually didn't. I thought they were the same thing, and now I feel silly for that.
So. Well, no, but that's understandable. But they both have missionary programs, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that's true.
So what happens to you after? I mean, you're so young still, but what happens to you after high school? And
well, I graduated high school. I had actually, I was abusing substances when I was a freshman in high school all through my high school career.
All your friends, was it?
Yeah, I surrounded myself with other people who were living the same lifestyle, and it was really tough, and I didn't realize how bad it was at the time.
This becomes an important part of your story, doesn't
it? Oh, yes, this is central. I don't think things would have turned out the way they did had I not been living that way, because I met Jesus through my addiction.
Now, were your folks aware of your
They addiction? Became aware. My poor mother, I put her through so much. I don't want to say she gave up because she loved me so much. And she did not give up. She prayed for me. I know that. Yeah. And that's, if it hadn't been for her, who knows what would have happened. But she eventually backed off and decided to let go and give me over to God.
Wow. And he did.
Oh, yeah. I remember one day thinking, I am so sick of living this way, but there is something in my brain that is making me want to use no matter what. Even though in my heart I want to stop, I don't want to live this way.
And how old were you at this point?
I was 19. Yeah. I was just turning 19. I was 18. Hmm. I turned 19 2 months after this. I was sitting in my car and something was wrong. Like I was blacking out. I couldn't eat. I couldn't drink anything. We don't know exactly what happened, but I was not in a good place. And I remember sitting in my vehicle and I threw whatever I was using on the ground and I said, I don't know who you are, because at the time I had taken on this agnostic, closer to atheist, like, I don't know. Yeah. But
it's easier to deal with life if you push God
that's true.
Off
that's
to the edge.
Very true. Because your conscience bugs you to death.
Yeah. And so you weren't in a good place with him at that point.
No, I was not. And I remember throwing my hands in the air dramatically, like, you know, I'm a dramatic person sometimes. I remember saying, I don't know who you are, but I know for a fact that if you're there, you don't want me doing this. But I can't stop, and I need you to help me stop. I want to stop. I want to stop desiring this in my life. And as soon as I said that, I turned my car on and I backed out of the parking lot I was in, and I actually blacked out after that. Don't remember anything.
Driving?
Yes. Oh. Very scary situation. God carried me the whole way. I drove 45 minutes to a hospital and I ended up there, and in this hospital bed, I hadn't eaten. I actually hadn't slept in a couple days either. I was not in a good place. I was laying on the bed and I finally started to fall asleep a little bit because I felt safe in the hospital, and I fell asleep. It was kind of like halfway, I was halfway conscious of what was going on, but Jesus appeared to me in my dream. I couldn't see his face though. There was no face. It was just like white light. Cause you know, I am the light of the world.
Yeah.
And there was a hand extending out to me and it said, it's okay. He said, it's okay. I'm here. I'm going to take it from here. Wow. And it was crazy. It was a crazy experience. And I woke up the next day feeling, wow. And I was like, I'm hungry. Where's breakfast? So I was able to eat. I hydrated myself, cause I was severely dehydrated too. Mm. Took a shower. And then, I was kind of like, what happened last night? And
did you remember the car experience?
Yes, I remember the car, but I blacked out. I don't remember driving, but I remember getting in my car, and then I remember going up to the front desk and telling them that I needed some help. Yeah. I made them aware of my situation.
Yeah.
So,
The next day you're just saying, what happened?
Yeah, I was like, what was going on? So then I felt like I just started walking through the unit we were in. It was kind of like a community thing. It was a behavioral health unit, actually.
And where was this at?
This was in Winchester, Virginia.
Okay. So still in Virginia. Okay.
Yes, I was still in Virginia at the time. Okay. Parents lived in West Virginia. We were right on the border of the state. So I went into like the kind of the lounge area for everyone. And I actually walked over to the bookshelf and I reached down without even really looking. And I picked up a Bible. Like, it was a King James Bible, and I was like, oh, yeah, my grandma read this. Like, she would say stuff, and I opened it up to Psalm 1, and I read, I cannot quote the verse, I don't remember, but it was about God is with people who turn away from ungodliness. I can't remember exactly what the first verse was, but it was...
It really struck you.
Yeah, I was like, oh, my goodness. So I actually read through the first two chapters of Psalms, and then I remember... a pastor saying, oh, start in the book of John in the New Testament. That's where you should start. So I went to the book of John.
You had heard a pastor say that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, in church one day. Because I tried to tune everything out. Like I would play on my I had video games that I bring, like
go to church.
Yes, yeah. I was a very rebellious teenager. Yeah. And so I started reading the book of John, and the book was a red letter Bible where it had Jesus' words in red. So I was like, you know, I don't really care about this stuff. I'm just going to read what Jesus said because he kind of talked to me.
You
last
know
night.
I did that too, didn't you? Mm-hmm. I mean, you've heard that probably.
Yes. And so I just went, I was like, I'm just going to read what Jesus said.
Isn't that neat?
And I was reading through, and I was like, the Holy Spirit. I had my born again experience the night before because I had accepted that invitation from Christ. Like in my dream, I reached out and grabbed his hand. So that's kind of like my born again experience. And, you know, the Holy Spirit, he gives us the Spirit after that happens. And I was reading what Jesus had said, and like everything was so clear. It had never been so clear before.
Appreciated those words a lot.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I have been just head over heels in love with Jesus ever since.
Like, this was like 4 years ago, right?
This was four years ago, actually. Last week marks the 4 year mark of when this happened. So that's kind of a little bit of my story.
Yeah. Oh, that's just wonderful. And so you stay in Virginia for a while longer?
Yeah. So since I was addicted, my parents suggested that I attend some form of recovery program. So I decided to go to a 12-step program. Mm. And having a relationship, not just like a fear-based thing, but an actual relationship with the God of our understanding is really important, and my God is the God of the Bible.
Right.
So this 12-step program really helped me pursue my God, my way, which was the Bible, and it was amazing. I actually, through the help of this program and through Jesus, I completely changed. I'm a new creature. The Bible says we're new creatures.
That's how I feel. Did your folks must have been ecstatic?
They were. My mother, my poor mother. I have two siblings
praying for you too all this time.
I have two siblings that she is still praying for, and she just calls me, and she's just thankful that I'm alive today, and that she doesn't have to worry about me as much.
I can imagine. What a wonderful relief.
My dad is so happy too. They're both in recovery as well. They both have 30 years under their belts though.
Oh, good for them.
They're so happy.
So you eventually get out this way.
Yes.
Come east. Is that the next part of the story? Or?
Yes. So I was sitting in my bed one day in West Virginia and thinking, I had not been able to find a job. And the closest one is a 45-minute drive. Mm-hmm. So it was just not... it was not a good place to be.
Nice commute.
Yeah. My brother was stationed at Hill Air Force Base at the time, up in Layton.
This is an older brother?
Yes, this is my older brother. And I called him and I said, I cannot be here anymore. This is not good. It's time for a change. And he offered to let me stay with him. Well, I got on my feet.
Wow.
So I moved out. I packed everything that I wanted to bring in one suitcase. And I attached my pillow to the suitcase, and I hopped on a plane, and I did not look back.
Oh, my goodness.
So it's been quite an adventure. I felt called out here, actually, because I was aware, like, since my brother lived out here, he was like, you know, there's a really large population of Mormons out here.
Did that worry you at all?
I was worried.
Yeah.
When the pastor of my church heard that I was going to be moving to Utah, he's like, you better watch out. And I was like, well, you know, I'm feeling called out here. I don't think it's as bad as you're making it out to be. So, and I'm glad that I didn't come here with the attitude of, I have to like put on the full armor of God and I have to fight these people. It wasn't like that for me. I met my husband a couple months after I moved out here, and he let me know that he was LDS in that.
Speaking of LDS or Mormons.
Yep. And I was like, oh, so you guys took the book of John out of your Bible. And he's like, what are you talking about? And because I was confused, I thought that I didn't realize there was a difference between, and I feel silly for this now, but I didn't realize there was a difference between Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons. Yeah. And then I learned the actual term, what they like to be called, which is Latter-day Saints. And I totally respect that. So I try not to use the term Mormon very often now, unless they bring it up.
Yeah. So. Well, now we're going to meet your husband next time, but without spilling his story too much, I guess, or spoiling it. But so you end up meeting and marrying. And did he Did he try to share his Mormonism with you? And
a little bit, like bits and pieces here and there, but I was kind of overpowering because I love Jesus. Yeah. I love him. I think about him all the time. He's like, it's really hard to explain. It's like when you're in junior high and you have a crush on somebody, it's like, I'm always thinking about Jesus because...
Isn't that amazing?
He saved me and changed me. Yeah. I could go on and on about the things that he's done in my life, like the job opportunities and people that I've been able to meet. Like, I'm a completely different person. If I was here today, but the way that I was, that...
You might not be here today.
I was antisocial. Yeah. I couldn't talk to people. I could not look people in the eye. It was so bad.
Did any of those Christian lessons that you may have not wanted to hear, but heard anyway because you were there, did they come back a little bit at all?
And
somebody knew about Jesus before I found him there?
Yes. Yeah. So the Bible says that the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword.
Right.
And like it pierced my soul even back then.
Yeah.
It did, because it's the word of God. And after I came to know Christ, like all these things came back to me. And I remember when I was probably 6 or 7 years old, I colored a picture. It was a little worksheet in Sunday school. And it was a picture of a little girl carrying an umbrella. And there was a Bible verse on it. And it says, cast all your cares upon him, for he careth for you. Mm. I can't remember the reference.
Yeah.
Really bad with that. But
now you understand what that means.
Oh, yes. Yeah. And I, like, it helps me every day. Like, today at work, I was in a lot of meetings today, and I was nervous because I just started my job, but I kept, okay, I got to cast my cares on him, and because he cares for me, like, he's going to help me through this. Like, he'll shut doors if they need to be shut, and he'll open doors that need to be open.
Yeah.
Like, and I don't have the level of anxiety that a lot of people do today, because I know that whatever happens,
it's
working
God's
it
hands.
For my good.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now, you ended up meeting with a bishop, I guess, at some point, because your husband, will again hear his story, but it had to do with him. What was that about?
Well, I wanted to meet with the bishop. Spencer and I were engaged, getting ready to be married. And I wanted Spencer... I explained to him a lot of differences, and I was trying to point out things from the doctrine that he may not have been completely...
You had learned some of these things.
Yes. I should add, when I moved out here, I actually began fervently studying the
Mormonism.
LDS doctrine.
Yeah.
I wanted to know everything because I am a perfectionist. I don't like to have incorrect information, especially when I'm trying to not necessarily defend or argue, but to like present facts about my beliefs. Like, I don't want to put anybody in a bad spot where they feel like I'm making things up and trying to attack them.
Right.
So I started to point this out to Spencer, and he didn't know a lot of the things about the doctrine and the history of the church. The history of the church is one of the big things.
Isn't that something?
I asked him if we could meet with the bishop of his childhood ward. And we did. And I just kind of asked the bishop questions. Is the doctrine and covenant says this? Is this true? Is this what you believe? And every time he said yes. And didn't really get a reaction from Spencer, but I could tell that he was finally hearing, like, okay, this is really what's going on. But I don't want to go too much into that.
No,
Spencer to be able to talk about
it. But that was an interesting experience.
It was. And the bishop was very respectful and very kind.
Didn't really have answers probably either.
No, there weren't answers, just more of a, yes, that's what we believe, or no, we don't actually believe that. But we didn't get any no's, because, I mean...
You know, it's funny, too, when you were talking about how Jesus is now so important in your life and in our lives. We would go on vacation with family, never mention Jesus' name at all as Mormons. And now as Christians, we just can't go a few hours, if at all, without something coming up or talking about
it. Always want to talk about him.
Yeah. And what do you think that is?
I think that...
Is that the Spirit of Christ, I guess, but...
Yeah, it's absolutely the Spirit. Like, when we accept Christ, he gives us the Holy Spirit. And I really think that is, he is the central part of our being now.
Yeah.
Because we have died. We've died and we've risen again.
And that's our goal, isn't it? To die to Christ and him living in us.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
I never understood that fully as a Latter-day Saint. And
I didn't understand it growing up either, even though that was one of the big things that was taught in my
probably week
belief.
After week it was taught of some sort. And
oh, yeah. And I never understood. I was like, what, dying, what? What? Yeah. Like, that doesn't make sense. Like, I couldn't even comprehend the new creature part. It's like, because I felt, oh, I already believe this. Like, I've been this since I was born, but, it changed when I accepted Christ. Like, I had the born again experience.
Yeah.
I did have a defining moment, and not everybody has that. And not everybody needs to
feel. And not everybody needs to feel like they have to have that. Right.
Yeah.
Cause I feel like I'm more of a new creature as well in that sense. I just see things differently. And Carla and I, my wife and I, started reading John as well, and it just, we were just crying.
It's fantastic.
Reading things there that I'd never read before, even though I'd read it before.
Like, Jesus talks about, I mean, the whole book of John, like all of the four Gospels, the central theme is God loves us so much with a fiery, burning passion. He is jealous for us.
Yeah.
Like, he's jealous for me. A former drug addict. He's jealous for my love.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Like, that's, I've always wanted that. I grew up, my father was absent most of the time. So
with traveling and stuff.
Yes, he worked two jobs, and he actually, one of his jobs, he stayed there overnight. That's where he slept. He drove a taxi cab, and he slept in his cab.
Oh my.
Yeah, it was really hard. So I had that hole in my heart, and I was looking to fill that, and I thought drugs had filled that, but they didn't. Jesus did.
Yeah.
It's amazing. He's like, God is my father. Like, he's my father in heaven. And
Abba Father.
Yes. Yeah. Like, we call out Abba. Like, Abba. I think in Hebrew, it's not even a word. It's just a sound that an infant would make, like, da-da.
Yeah.
That's really what it means. And it's,
and that's what it means to have a relationship.
Yes.
Right? And that's so different in Mormonism. It's so much of a religion as opposed to a relationship. It's all about the church. It's all about keeping the commandments.
Yes, and my heart hurts.
Yeah.
My heart hurts for my family because they are my family. I'm married to Spencer, and they're very much a part of my family as my biological. I spend more time with them than I ever have with my family.
Oh, you mean Spencer's family?
Yes, yes.
Because they're active.
Yes.
Yeah.
And my heart just hurts
just
every
wish
time.
Wish their eyes could open just a little
bit. Yes, and that's up to God.
What do you think most Mormons misunderstand or are not doing? I mean, what should they be doing in order to?
The biggest thing for me, this is, and everybody's different. I've noticed that. Like, even with Spencer, when we met, there are a lot of things that he was already doing that, were more toward Christianity. Like, he explained to me, like, these things that you're telling me, like, I believe some of those. Like, I believe that I have a relationship with God. And I think that's the biggest thing, is the relationship.
They might think they do and they really don't. Is that what you mean? What I mean is, we use, in Mormonism, we use the same words as Christians do.
Yes.
But in the back of our mind, they mean something totally different.
Yes.
Saved in Mormonism only means that you're resurrected.
Yes.
It doesn't mean exaltation or living with heavenly, or with God.
Yes.
Yeah. Grace means something different.
Yes. And that's something that really, it hurts my heart.
Yeah.
Like, I try not to get angry about it with people. Like, you should be believing this.
Right.
Like, that is totally,
it probably doesn't do any good.
It's
right?
Completely ineffective. It pushes people away.
Right.
Like, if Jesus does that to us, like, we're more inclined to listen to him. Like, he kind of did that for me. Like, he reached out. He's like, come on, come with me. But he was kind of stern about it.
Yeah.
And that, I actually felt safe with that tone from him. Like, it's going to be okay.
And you reached out as well.
Yes.
And
it's like,
his hand.
Like, I trust you. I have confidence in you.
Yeah.
Like, that's.
Well, now, sitting in the car, kind of going back to that, just made me think, did anything happen? I mean, I know you were kind of broken at that moment, but did anything happen just before that? Had you heard anything that, or you just felt like, I can't do this anymore? What?
Well, actually, the situation was kind of unusual. I think that I had taken something that I wasn't aware that I was taking. Oh, so
that would always scare me.
It was so scary. Yeah. I was terrified. I was so scared. I actually called my mother.
Yeah.
Right before this happened, I called my mother and I asked her, I said, I need you to drive me to the hospital. Something's wrong. And she did the most important thing she could have ever done for me, being my mother. She let go and she said, I am at work and I cannot help you anymore.
You're in God's hands.
Yeah, she said that to me. And
it turned out to be
that was the best thing that she's ever done for me.
Isn't God gracious, though?
Yes.
And, you know, that's another unfortunate part of Mormonism. We expect people to be perfect before they come to church, almost.
It's so sad.
It is, isn't it?
Jesus said, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden. I will give you rest. Not go take a shower, go put a suit on, go cut your hair, shave your beard, and then come talk to me. Like, he said, no, he picked me. I like the way somebody put, I can't remember who it was, but they said that I was in the trench and Jesus crawled in there with me and he sat down with me and met me there and talked to me. And that's exactly what he did for me, because my Jesus became a man. My God and my Father in heaven became a man in the form of his Son. And he knows what it's like to be hungry and tired.
Isn't that neat? And you know what? Our time's gone.
Wow.
Can you believe that?
Oh, my goodness.
But one thing, your thought, you either said this or it prompted me to think, but it was like Jesus shows us the way as Mormons.
Yes.
Jesus shows us the way, but in Christianity, Jesus is the way.
He is the way.
He doesn't just show us. He's our Savior, and he is the way.
He says, I am the way, the truth, and the light.
Yeah.
No one goes to the Father except by me.
Yeah. Well, Dorothy, thank you so much. That's awesome. I just appreciate your story, and we're going to get to hear a little bit of what Spencer has and his perspective. And you've enjoyed it out here in Utah then?
I love it. This is my home.
Is it?
I felt like I've lived here my whole life.
Oh, yeah.
I love it here.
Like the snow and everything else.
I love everything. The snow and the rain and the sunshine all in one day.
Well, as Dorothy said, let's encourage you folks to read John. Galatians and Ephesians and Acts. And as Mormons, we have a thin veneer of understanding of the Bible, and we don't trust it. Mm-hmm. But it is trustworthy, and it's the Word of God, and it'll speak to you as the same as it has to us in our lives. So
trust God. He won't lead you astray.
Thanks. See you next time.